working. Yeah, it is working. Thank you. Thank you. So let's continue. First of all, I'll just go through the ones from yesterday. There's quite a few left, and then we'll get on to the new ones afterwards. So I'll try to be a bit more efficient than I was yesterday, because there's quite a lot here now, which is actually great. I really like it when people ask questions, because it's good to have a bit of discussion about issues. It tends to clarify things a little bit. So, number one, Venerable Sir, what is the most practical way to, one, attain an adequate degree of mindfulness before commencing meditation and maintaining it out throughout the meditation? Thank you. So, to attain that, the mindfulness, the you know, one of the things is in a large sense, the attaining of mindfulness is very much part of the overall practice of the path. Yeah, so it really depends a lot on how you live your ordinary life and all these kind of things. And so in the long term, what you should really try to do is to, if you can, enhance your practice of kindness and morality and all of these kind of things, including how you use your mind. And if you use your mind generally well on a day-to-day basis, you will find that your mindfulness improves. So when you come back next year, yeah, you're going to come back next year. Is it going to be next year? Well, no, there's always going to be next year anyway. So somebody's going to be doing a retreat somewhere next year for sure. And then hopefully you will have more mindfulness at that point, yeah, because you have improved. When it is giving rise to mindfulness on a retreat like this, there's only so much you can do. Because it all depends on how you live your life generally, but the idea is basically just to wait. You know, the reason why the mindfulness is not there is because you are tired initially. You are restless because the mind is used to running around. So a lot of it is just to wait and allow things to die down. And when those kind of superficial hindrances die down, then mindfulness tends to come back again. A lot of it is just the idea of just being, you know, patient, waiting for it to arise. This is why we don't talk on the retreat, because when we don't talk, you don't deplete your energy and these kind of things. So these things are, you know, the mindfulness gradually comes back up again. But it's basically almost like an automatic thing. What matters the most is how you live your life outside of the retreat. But again, there is, you know, this little thing that I've been emphasizing throughout, the idea of right attitude is so important. Okay. If you are enjoying the present moment, if the present moment is pleasant, then it's quite easy to be mindful. If the present moment is miserable, it's very hard to be mindful. You want to make it as pleasant as possible. So your attitude really matters a lot. Giving it priority matters. Yeah, mm-hmm. Understanding that meditation, mindfulness is significant. And once you get that, you don't kind of waste time thinking about this and that. So this is really the way, not to use force. This is kind of the traditional way that people give rise to mindfulness, is using force, trying to hold on to it, grasp onto the present moment. I would not recommend that, even though you can do that for a short time and sustain it for a short time. In the long run, you just get tired and you get exhausted and you lose your energy. It doesn't really work. If you allow the mindfulness to come naturally, it comes together with energy. And when it comes together with energy, that is when it is very useful and very, it actually will help you to achieve samadhi and all these other kinds of things. But the reality is that many of these things are long-term practices, and this is why you have the Noble Eightfold Path. It takes a while for, you know, the ethics of the path to kind of do their work on you, so that you kind of, you feel better about yourself, and kind of things emerge from that. I hope that it's kind of hope that helps. So, next one. Dear Ashramali, sometimes during meditation I feel an internal buzz, as if my ears were ringing. It can be so strong that it buffers out side noise. And can be more prominent than my breath. Would you recommend going with this buzz, or is it better to try to focus on the breath? Okay, I think I know. Okay, so it's an interesting question. There's always these kind of questions about the various things happening in meditation practice. So in this case, it depends on what kind of internal buzz it is. And if it is a buzz that comes with happiness and piti and peace and calm, and you have all the right emotional qualities going with it, then it's a good buzzer. Yeah, and a good buzzer. It's the right thing is happening. You don't have to worry about it. Just allow it to be. You don't need to do anything about it. Stay with the breath, because the breath is the object which gave rise to that positive state in the first place, if it is a positive state. So stay with the breath. Forget about the buzz. Leave it in the background. If it is a happy feeling, stay with the breath and the happy feeling. Allow it to be there. And as you do that, that positive state will evolve further, and that buzz will eventually disappear, and you will be left just with the happiness, just with the piti, just with the prasadi and tranquility. Yeah, so that is the, I would say, the way to do this. And in meditation, all kind of things, all kind of perceptions tend to arise, all kind of, and a lot of them are just irrelevant. They arise because the mind is becoming peaceful. The mind is a very powerful creative force. The mind will create all these perceptions. But actually, they are irrelevant. Hang out with the breath. Stay with the breath. Allow these things to kind of take a backstage. They will still be there, because you don't push them away or anything like that. You allow them to be, but you make the breath your main focus. Dear Ramana, thank you for teaching directly from the Sutta. I really appreciate that. I also think it's essential to try to develop our practice around what the Buddha actually taught. Thank you. Okay, that's good. That is a really easy question. So that's great. So, oops. Certainly this thing really fires off, doesn't it? Okay. If the Sutta state that the Buddha shaved his head and went forth, how come statues depict him with curls and a bun? Yes, it is a good question. And the answer to that is that when you read the Sutta, there's something called the 32 marks of a great man. You heard about that? It's kind of a really weird thing that you find in the suttas. And it seems to be some kind of inheritance from the Brahmanical traditions. The Brahmins had this idea that if you are a really great person, you have 32 marks. Yeah, and some of those marks are actually depicted on the Buddha statues to kind of prove that this is a great man or whatever, you know, great person. And these are really weird marks, and I personally think it's completely irrelevant to Buddhism. I don't know what it is doing in the suttas. Probably something that was added later on, because the Buddha never talks about these things. They're kind of descriptions that come outside of the Buddha's discourses. So I think they are utterly irrelevant. But this is the kind of basis on which these things are done. And one of these marks is that the Buddha's hairs, yeah, he has exactly one hair to each pore, yeah, to each kind of... So one hair comes out and it always curls in the right hand direction, like that, clockwise direction. So if you look at the Buddha's head, this one is not so clear because it doesn't have the kind of, it's not detailed enough, but you will see that usually there is this curl going in a clockwise direction. Or is it anti-clockwise? I think it's clockwise. That is one reason why they use it, because it shows that it is the Buddha, because the Buddha is the only one who has kind of these strange marks. Yeah, I don't know why, you know, we kind of carry on with these things, but that's actually the way it is. And then the bun on the back of the Buddha's head, this is another one of these great marks. The idea that there's a protrusion on the top of the Buddha's head. Yeah, that for some reason, that is also one of these marks. Another one is the mark between the eyes, you see sometimes. The Buddha apparently had a brow almost went straight across, and that mark between the eyes shows the kind of continuity of the eyebrow. I don't think the Buddha had any of these marks, because they are rather strange. One of the things that you see in the sutras is that Buddha was often mistaken for one of the other monks. They couldn't distinguish between the Buddha and the other monks. Well, if they couldn't distinguish, then the Buddha would have looked pretty much like everyone else. But if the Buddha looked really weird, everybody would have seen straight away that's the Buddha. Yeah, it doesn't make any sense, you know. So that's where it comes from. But in terms of iconography, yeah, in terms of kind of making artwork out of the Buddha, it is quite useful, because then you know this is the Buddha. Yeah, we're all very clear. If it is an artwork or an iconography of another monk like Venerable Sariputta or Mahamoggallana, they don't have those marks. They often have a shaven head. Yeah, if you see statues of Sariputta, he often sits like this. Yeah, this is how he sits. So, yeah, one hand on the knees and the other one kind of behind there. So that's how you see Venerable Sariputta, and he should always be on the right-hand side of the Buddha. Yeah, because he's the right-hand monk of the Buddha. Mahamoggallana, he sits here, he usually has his hand under there like this. He should then be on the left-hand side, two of the chief disciples. Anyway, so I hope that helps your meditation practice. I've been very naughty, I apologize. But it's important to be able to ask these questions. I appreciate that. So it's not the... So it's good. Please ask anything you like. I don't mind, and as long as people have a chance to leave whenever they want, it's not an issue, I think. Dear Ajahn Brahmali, whilst it would be nice to think that I could become enlightened in this life, okay, whilst it would be nice, okay, the minimum attainment that I would feel glad about is stream entry. Okay, I'm glad to hear that. As from that point on, we are definitely leaving samsara. On the main features of stream entry seems to be seeing through identity view, Sakaya Ditti. Could you say something about Sakaya Ditti? Thanks. So Sakaya Ditti is the idea, or not the idea, is the view that there is something permanent in the five khandhas. Yeah, the Sakaya Ditti, there's something in the five khandhas that is inherent, that is always there, an inherently existing part of the five khandhas. And usually the way that it is described in the Sutta Sakaya Ditti is that the self is identical with the khandha. Yeah, in other words, one of the five aggregates, yeah, the vijnana, consciousness, perception, feeling, volition, or form. So either you are identical with that particular personality aspect or that khandha, or you are, it is, that khandha is in you. Or you are in the khandha, or you are the owner of the khandha. Yeah? So this is kind of the four ways that is usually described in the sutta. So in other words, there is some relationship between what you take to be yourself and the khandhas. That is really the point. Everything is related to the khandhas one way or another. That's Sakaya Ditti. But what it means is that you have this sense that there is an inherent essence, yeah, within this thing you call body and mind, yeah, this nama rupa, there is some kind of inherent essence in that. That's really what it comes down to. And it's very hard to pinpoint. Yeah, if you were to ask somebody like a psychologist or a philosopher, is there an inherent essence in the human being, they would say no. Yeah? Does that mean that they have understood or penetrated Sakaya Ditti? No, it does not mean that. This is kind of the interesting thing. You can have the view, like a superficial view, that there is no essence to a human being, and still have Sakaya Ditti here. Why is that? Because Sakaya Ditti is a much more profound thing. It is a kind of, it's a nebulous feeling that somehow you exist, but you can't really pin it down. So it's possible to have a superficial feeling that there isn't, and yet you still have that nebulous feeling that you exist in a permanent sense, regardless of that. So it is very hard to pin down, and the problem is that it's so much part of us that it's almost hard to really grasp. Yeah? It is hard to kind of really understand what it is, because we're so immersed in Sakaya Ditti, we've always had it, that you can't pinpoint it. And because you can't pinpoint it, that's what makes it difficult to penetrate and understand that this is actually a problem. But generally it is this sense that you exist somehow, the me, the I, yeah, the ego. And then the projecting of that ego onto an aspect of your personality. Yeah. That's really what it is. So becoming a stream enter is a psychological revolution. Yeah. It's a massive psychological revolution. This is important to understand, that it's a kind of a complete upside down turning of what you thought life was or reality was all about. Yeah, the feeling, suddenly understand that this thing that you had been carrying around with you all the time, the sense of a self, is false. Yeah, it doesn't correspond to any reality. Yeah. It is just a delusion. It's a massive change. You understand what impermanence suddenly is. Because of you have given up the sense of self, you're able to see the five khandhas as suffering for the first time. it's impossible to see the five khandhas as suffering as long as you have a degree of identity. If you identify with the five khandhas, you can't see them as suffering because you want to protect your identity. Yeah, you want to see happiness where you identify with something. Because you want to see happiness there, it's impossible to see these things as suffering because of that identity view. It gets in the way of that. So it is that identity view, once that's abandoned, that allows you to see things according to reality. Before that, it's going to be distorted through the vested interest that you have in preserving your identity here. Okay. I hope I'm making sense. If I don't make sense, please say so on the note, yeah? So next time around. That's perfectly okay here. Dear Ajahn, can you please briefly talk about the Garudhammas and why these may or may not be in the EVPs? Thank you. Garudhammas, okay. So the Garudhammas are these are kind of special rules that were laid down at some stage for the bhikkhunis. Yeah, and these rules are controversial because they seem to be a little bit kind of sexist, perhaps, or a little bit kind of putting kind of the nuns, the bhikkhunis, under the kind of the control of the bhikkhus or something to that effect. So they're kind of controversial because they don't really fit with modern ideas of gender equality. Yeah. At least some of them, not all of them, but some of them are like that. And the two most problematic ones of the Garudhammas is the first one, where it says that any bhikkhuni who has been ordained even for 100 years had to bow down to, or, you know, pay respect to a monk who has been ordained that very day. So there's, in other words, the monks are always kind of considered to be of a higher status than the bhikkhunis, regardless of the, you know, the relative degree of length you have been ordained or whatever. No. And then there's the last one, the eighth Garudhamma, which says that a bhikkhuni is never allowed to criticize a monk, but a monk is allowed to criticize a bhikkhuni. Yeah. Yeah, so this seems a bit strange, right? That doesn't sound kind of reasonable from a modern perspective. And the other Garudhammas too may be regarded, they are not, you know, they are more reasonable, but these ones are the two worst ones. But one of the things about the Garudhammas that, you know, are they part of the EBTs, if this is like the early Buddhist text or not? It's a controversial topic. So many people have argued that they are not part of the early Buddhist text because they have shown inconsistencies with the Garudhammas, how they don't kind of, the inconsistency between the Garudhammas and the rules of the Patimokkha, for example, and many other things which are problematic with the Garudhammas. That is one side of it. I can't really actually remember even all the arguments right now. But there's also been the other argument. This is the argument made by one monk in particular, that actually they are early. And the reason why he has made the argument that they are early, part of the early Buddhist text, is because they're found across the board. Yeah? All schools have the Garudhammas. There's very little evidence that from a comparative study that they are late. Of course, even if they exist in all schools, they can still be after the time of the Buddha. And if you can show that they are after the time of the Buddha, well then, essentially, they are not really binding on monastics. Because the Buddha made it very clear before he passed away that those rules I have laid down already, those are the ones you're supposed to keep. You're not really supposed to make up any new ones. That's what he said. And still, of course, people make up rules afterwards. Large numbers of them, actually. Yeah. So, but I think the whole question of whether they are, how original they are, or not original, or whatever, I think we can sidestep that whole issue here. Because one of the things about the Garudhammas to me is that they are minor rules. People think that they are major rules because they are called Garudhammas. Garu means like important or heavy or you know, whatever. Dhamma is like a rule, so it sounds like there are important rules, but actually, when you look at the punishment you get for breaking them, there's no punishment for these rules. And because there's no punishment for breaking them, apart from where they are also found in the Patimokkha, because there's no punishment, it means that they are minor rules. Only very minor rules are of that category. There's no punishment, or there's no, you know, call it dukkha offense, you have to confess it afterward. That's really the whole punishment is all about. So So these are minor rules. And the minor rules of the Vinaya, if you look at things like the Saikya rules, is the most minor category of rules in the Vinaya. And they are only offenses if you break them out of disrespect. And I'll give you an example. It's a very simple example in there. One example is that, for example, you are not allowed, you shouldn't be standing up and to teach people who are sitting down. Yeah, because in ancient India, if you're sitting down, it's like a posture which is more elevated than standing. Well, we still have the same today to some extent, yeah? But I think that is still true to some extent. But for example, if you go to a lecture theater at a university, the lecturer will stand up, all the students will sit down. It doesn't mean that the students are being disrespectful to the lecturer. It's just the way we do things now. You're still considered respectful, even if you're sitting down in that situation. So then, monks will do the same thing. Yeah, if you go to university, you hold a lecture, you can stand up because you're not breaking the rule out of disrespect. You're breaking it because it doesn't really apply anymore. And it's exactly the same thing with the Garuda monks. Yeah, these are minor rules, just like the Saikya rules. They are not rules that you have to keep if they are no longer relevant to modern society. So I would say some of these rules we don't have to keep them. They're not really relevant. We're not keeping them out of this respect. We're simply keeping them because they're not appropriate to modern society. So, and it's quite interesting. We had I actually invited one of the senior vicars and Dhammasara monks to give a talk to the monks. And I don't ramble away here. That was it's actually quite nice to do that because you change kind of the feelings of, you know, the gender dynamics between the male and the female sangha. It's kind of interesting to do things differently. Ajahn Brahm was actually one of the first who did that. He invited Ayakema, the very famous German nun who passed away a few years ago. He invited her to give a talk at Bodhinala Monastery back in 1992, a long time ago. Even some of the monks were not happy with that because they were more conservative, but it certainly, you know, there's no reason why that shouldn't be done. So we did the same thing at our monastery very recently. I invited the senior nun at the Masara Monastery, Venerable Hasapanya. She gave a talk to the monks, and afterwards, a number of junior monks, they bowed down to her. Yeah, I didn't ask them to do that, they just did it automatically. And that shows you that, you know, in our monastery, there is a natural sense almost of, you know, at least to a large extent, of gender equality. And people are quite happy to bow down to them. Nobody has any problem with that. And that's kind of nice. And that means that this rule that we have, you know, the first rule of the Garuda Mother, actually, it is basically we consider it as defunct and not really relevant anymore. So that is the short answer. The long answer, you have to go online and you have to read many books and to figure it out for yourself. There's a lot of reading material on these things. So, there you are. Dear Ajahn, can you please explain the steps of dependent liberation? Thank you. Dependent liberation are the steps. It starts off with sila, with morality. Yeah? And so you start off practicing sila, and remember that when I talk about sila, we mean sila in its very broadest sense, including the mental sila and all of these things. That is how we regard sila in this case. Once you practice sila in the right way, then you have non-remorse, non-regret. You don't have any regrets in life. It means that your mind tends to become brighter. Sometimes when we talk about regret, it doesn't just mean that we think, oh yeah, I shouldn't have done that, that was really stupid, that was really silly of me. Sometimes it just means that your mind becomes a little bit more dark and murky. Yeah, you're lacking the buoyancy, the lightness, the brightness of the mind. It makes it a bit more dark and kind of murky in there. That's what it means in a sense, because you kind of feel, you don't feel good about yourself. So once you have that non-regret, from that comes the pamoja. Pamoja is gladness, because you feel glad about your conduct. You think, yeah, I'm living well. Yeah, you're kind of happy about yourself. So you feel gladness. And then this, where we are talking about now, is really meditation practice. Yeah, this happens through meditation practice. So when sila and meditation come together, this is why it is so powerful. Behave yourself. So when sila and meditation comes together, yes, you have the pamuja, the gladness comes, and from the gladness when you meditate, meditation starts to calm down, you get the piti, which is the rapture and the joy. And as your meditation goes further, you get the pasadi, which is the calm and tranquility. Yeah, going down, down, down. More and more peaceful, more and more quiet, and more profound sense of happiness and joy as this happens. Yeah, you start to feel like a rock, you can sit there forever. That's how it feels like. Yeah. From that tranquility comes the sukha, the profound sense of happiness. And once you have a profound sense of happiness, the mind is glued on to the meditation. You can't stop yourself meditating anymore because it's so nice. And that is how samadhi happens. Yeah, you enter a deep state of samadhi. Yeah. Once you have the samadhi, because the mind has become very powerful, all the hindrances are abandoned. When you come out of that, you have the yathabhuta nahadasana, seeing things in accordance with reality. Yeah. And the part of that is the seeing of dukkha. And when you see dukkha, you get nibbida, you get the sense of repulsion from the world. You're repelled by the world because you see dukkha. You see everything is dukkha. Okay, we're repelled by everything. Because you have nibbida, the repulsion from the world, you get the viraga, the fading away of craving. Craving fades away. And then you have the vimutti, which is the liberation, complete liberation from craving, which is also the liberation from rebirth and all that. This is how it works, dependent liberation. Yeah, this process of meditation, really, that's what it's all about. And it's very similar to the seven factors of awakening. It almost follows exactly the same sequence. Yeah, and of course, the seven factors of awakening, well, they are part of the 37 Bodhipakya Dhamma that we looked at on the very first day, core aspect of the Buddha's teachings. Yeah, so this is very core, very central to Buddhism. When we talk about dependent liberation, it's not some kind of a marginal teaching on the side, which doesn't really matter. It's absolutely core and central to what is to this path. And as I mentioned before, I think I mentioned it before, that if you go to the Chinese agamas, which also preserve these teachings, but through the Sarvastivada tradition, it is identical virtually to the way it is found in the suttas, which makes dependent liberation very clearly almost verbatim a teaching of the Buddha. Okay, how do we handle memories of unskillful actions when they emerge during meditation? And then you have a smile on the bottom. Again, you are smiling about it. That's good. So, how do you handle memories of unskillful past actions? Well, you have to forgive yourself. Yeah. How can you forgive yourself? And the way that you can forgive yourself is to understand that you are conditioned. You are like everyone else. You are very conditioned into the person you are. The reason you have done unskillful actions in the past is because the circumstances conspired against you, and then you almost like you have no choice but to do unskillful actions. Yeah, it's like, you know, if you are born in a mafia family, and they say, well, if you want to be part of our family, you've got to go out and do dodgy things. Yeah, you've got to kill a few people and steal a few things and extort a little bit here, extort a little bit there. And if you do that, then good on you. You know, that's really great. That's good stuff. Of course, if you are reborn in that kind of situation, it's almost as if you have no choice. It's very, very hard to... This is your family. These are your family members. And it's very difficult to extract yourself from that kind of situation. But we're all a little bit like that. We all have unfortunate conditioning working on us. And because of that, we end up doing unskillful things. So understand that. You didn't really have much choice. Yeah, this is the point. When you look back on things in retrospect, it feels like I could have done things differently. But remember, retrospect always lies to you. Retrospect is a different point of view from when you actually were there. Retrospect is not the reality. So forget about retrospect. And the reality is that at that time, you didn't have much choice. You had to do pretty much those things. And the more you get that, the more you see that the circumstances conspired against you, you had to do that, the more easy it is to forgive yourself. Yeah, you're okay. You are here on this retreat. You're practicing 8 precepts. I can guarantee you, you are, you know, the queen of the cream. Yeah, otherwise you wouldn't be here. Nobody would be here just to torture themselves, or maybe some of you are here just to torture yourself. I don't know. I doubt it. Yeah. You are guaranteed you are a good person. And if you are here, someone said the other day felt that they weren't a very good meditator, but It's not about being a good meditator. There's no such thing as a bad meditator. What matters is that you are trying. Yeah. What matters is that you are improving a little bit. That's what matters. So don't think about yourself as a good meditator or a bad one or an average one. That's all rubbish. Think of yourself as doing the right thing right now, moving in the right direction. That is what matters. And then you are on the right path. And you can feel good about yourself. Yeah. You are improving. Yay, I'm improving. Yeah. That is the right way of thinking about things. And then you can feel good about yourself regardless of any past actions and all of these kind of things. You've got to, it's all about perspective. Right perspective is really the thing that this is all about. Dear Ajahn, I just wanted to express my gratitude to my fellow retreatants who have all been so courteous and kind. E.g. giving people way, opening doors, giving people space, not rushing, etc. Thank you. That is very nice. So that is great. And that kind of this is a wonderful way of having a harmonious retreat. And when people kind of look after each other, you have a sense of courtesy and you do the right thing. That's wonderful. So thank you for bringing that up. Dear Ajahn, could you please tell us what forms of ill will exist and how to overcome them? Yes, I will talk about how to deal with ill will in a couple of, maybe tomorrow or the day after, something like that. Probably tomorrow, actually. And I will talk about that specifically. But the forms of ill will, I could maybe just, basically ill will comes in a vast kind of number of degrees, yeah, from the kind of slightest irritation to the massive rage, yeah, and there's all kind of degrees in between there, and so that is really the forms of ill will, and the idea is to overcome all of those forms, including the slightest irritations, of course, obviously the massive rage, you want to avoid that, but even the small irritations is good to overcome, because there isn't really any, it's not necessary to be irritated by anything. So I'll leave that out for now because we have so many questions. I'm going to talk about that in a couple of sessions anyway, hopefully tomorrow. Dear Ajahn, does Perth accept ordained females? Can I know of any other places that this is possible? Does Perth accept? I'm not sure if Perth ordains females. I think Perth is like a city, yeah? So the city. No, I've been naughty again. Do we do that in Perth? Yes, we do. We have a nuns' monastery in Perth. Yeah, we have a bhikkhuni monastery. There's, I think, 11 bhikkhunis there now. And, right?
13, latest count.
I think that's included in some areas, yeah? So 11 bhikkhunis, 2 Saman areas, I think, yeah. That's what I heard anyway, yeah. So, yeah, so a large and very beautiful monastery, 600 acres of land. Yeah, if you're going to get 600 acres in the UK, it'll cost you, you know, you have to kind of be kind of a billionaire to buy 600 acres in the UK. Yeah. So it's kind of out of reach. But Australia is this large, empty space. So there's nothing there. You can get these very large pieces of land fairly inexpensively. Yeah. And then you have Ajahn Brahm, he's your fundraiser. Yeah. It's a bit like that. He kind of goes around and says, oh, you know, now we're raising funds for Vedabhachanda. And then because he gives a nice talk, people get inspired and they donate funds for Vedabhachanda here or for Dhammasala Monastery or for whatever, basically. Yeah. And that's a wonderful thing that people get inspired in that way. Yeah. So yes, we do. 600 acres of land. It's almost completely self-contained because the buildings are all at the bottom in the middle and then the land goes up to hills on the side. So when you're in the middle there, all you can see is forest in all directions. There's no sense of any neighbors or anything like that. It's a feeling of almost absolute seclusion. In that sense, it's better than Bodhinyana Monastery, because in Bodhinyana Monastery, there is a little bit more traffic noise. But there, you feel like you are in the middle of nowhere. So it's a very beautiful place, and to me, I feel it's a very nice community as well. I think always like to go, I usually go there once a month or something to give a teaching to the nuns. They keep on inviting me, so as long as they invite me, I go there. And so yes, but it is difficult to get the space there. Yeah, it is not easy because it is both Bodhinyana Monastery and Dhammasara are very popular. And so that is why it is such a wonderful thing that Venerable Chanda is taking charge of trying to establish a bhikkhuni monastery in the UK. It is a great thing because we need more such monasteries, more possibilities of ordaining women who are, you know, practicing the spiritual life to as bhikkhunis. It is so important that we have that possibility also here in the UK. So this is one of the reasons I'm here, is really to also to support that project, because I think it is a wonderful project. And I hope that other people feel the same way. It will be great if that is the case. So, are there any other places that ordain bhikkhunis? And there are other places in California. There are a few monasteries in California, especially around the Bay Area, San Francisco area. There's 3 or 4 monasteries there, actually, that ordain bhikkhunis, but they're quite small, and they are still developing. So there's more work to be done, as established. Perth is probably one of the most established bhikkhuni monasteries in the Western world, at least. There's also a monastery which is kind of an old monastery called Santi Monastery near Sydney in Australia, which also is like a nun's monastery. There's a monastery near Melbourne called Newbury Buddhist Monastery, which is also associated with Ajahn Brahm. But these are all kind of developing. Yeah, it's not really a very stable place yet to go to. Then, of course, there is in Asia, there's many possibilities. In Sri Lanka, the Bhikkhuni Sangha is very strong. There's a couple of thousand Bhikkhunis, as far as I know, in Sri Lanka. But not easy to find the kind of support that you find in places like Perth. In Perth, the support is very good, in part because Ajahn Brahm is behind it. In Thailand, there is a growing number of bhikkhunis. There's over 100 bhikkhunis now in Thailand. And it's getting a lot of support from the local population. One of the bhikkhuni monasteries called Nirodharam, found in Chiang Mai, is a very beautifully developed bhikkhuni monastery. It has a lot of support and getting being funded by some fairly wealthy supporters, so that they have really good buildings and all that kind of thing. Yeah. And I went to Thailand in January, and I visited a small monastery in rural Thailand. It's really, really far away, but a very simple little monastery, but very beautiful, very quiet. And they have collected lots of bhikkhunis. How many bhikkhunis came to this one? So it's 60, I think maybe 60. You may be right. Bhikkhunis and some of the areas, everyone together. It was about 60 there. You're probably right. They said it was the biggest congregation of bhikkhunis in Thailand ever. And they invited me to give talks about Vinaya and that kind of stuff. That was quite nice. And that was actually quite a beautiful monastery, but very undeveloped. And it needs quite a lot of funding to really get it going properly there. So these are some of the possibilities. But if you are interested, I would suggest that you speak to Venerable Chanda, because she obviously knows much more about this than I do. And then you can get some of the most up-to-date information about these things. So there you are. Yeah. Hey Ajahn, what is your view of the effects of caffeine generally and on the practice of meditation? Thank you. Effects of caffeine, it's not something that makes you deluded. I would say you don't really get deluded by caffeine. So because it doesn't delude you, it's not a problem as far as meditation is concerned in that sense. So experiment with these things. See what it does to you. Yeah, it is not something that you have to avoid. If you find it useful in the morning to kind of wake you up a little bit and it kind of helps your meditation, use a bit of caffeine, that's perfectly okay. Have a cup of tea, a cup of coffee, whatever. And if you find that it makes you restless or it makes your mind buzz, some people find coffee really terrible, don't use it. So the idea here is really to experiment. This is neither wrong nor right. It really depends on your personal situation. Monastic life seems to be the path described by the Buddha to get out of samsara. Some people might not be able to take the path because of reasons that are not related to attachment to sex, to soft beds, late dinners, entertainment, that are not related to that, okay, etc. Is there anything in the suttas that mentions that lay people could accept their life for what it is, instead of thinking that it is wasted? As they are not a monk or a nun. It is not wasted because you're not a monk or a nun. Please don't think like that. Yeah, it is perfectly, you're quite right. Sometimes you have responsibilities in life, we have things that we have to do. It is never wasted because you're not a monk or another. Well, the only thing is that the monastic life is laid down to maximize the speed of progress on the path. But if you live well as a lay person, you can go a long way as a lay person. Don't think that you are some kind of second-class citizen. Sometimes the lay people are more high-class citizens than the monastics. Yeah, it is just so variable. So it is not. It doesn't work like that. So if you live your life well, and you practice your virtues, and you are kind and generous, and you do all the right things, you can go a long way in lay life. So please don't think of the practice in that way. Make the most out of your situation. And then you will have a happy life, and you will be progressing towards Nibbana as a consequence. Does anything say about in the suttas? Well, the suttas have stories about lay people who were stream entries, lay people who were anagamis, yeah, non-returners, lay people who attained the four jhanas. Some of these lay people, they live almost like monastics, yeah, and maybe that is what you want to do as well. You can live almost like a monastic in lay life. You can live celibate, you can keep the 7 or 8 precepts all the time. One of the lay people here told me that she keeps 8 precepts all the time. I said to her, why should you want to do that? That maybe it's too much. Especially not eating in the afternoon can be incredibly difficult if you live lay life, because work and all of these kind of things. But you can do 7 precepts, yeah, or 7.5 or something like that. Make up your own kind of new ideas. And if you do live lay life well, good on you. And this is a wonderful thing. So please take that opportunity and make the most of it in that situation. If you can't do that, perfectly okay. Okay, dear Ajahn Mali, could you talk about vitakka and vichara? Okay, number 2, nimitta, are they appear spontaneously on every occasion? 3, kasina meditation practice, for who is it useful and when? Okay, so vitakka and vichara, applied and sustained thought, that is often how they are translated. Now, these are quite often controversial. If you look at discussions, that I don't think they're controversial, but some people think that this is controversial. And these words have different meaning, depend on context. And this is in part of the reason why they are controversial. So, the basic meaning of a word like vitakka is thought. Yeah? And in ordinary usage in the suttas, when you see the word vitakka, it means thought. Yeah, vichara means something similar. It means like the searching of the mind, in other words, like a rumination or thought or whatever. Yeah. So this is what they mean in ordinary usage. But remember that the thought, yeah, or even thought in ordinary life has a very vast range. Yeah, it goes from very coarse thoughts and a lot of thinking to very, very refined things. And so when we use vitakka vichara as jhana factors, as factors of the first jhana, then there they have a very different meaning. Why? Because when you come to the second jhana, then vitakka vichara is completely gone. Yeah? So the vitakka vichara remains in the first jhana is the most refined form of vitakka and vichara that is possible in experience. After that, it ceases completely. Yeah? And because it is the most refined idea of thinking, it does not, obviously, it does not mean thinking in a normal sense. It means the most refined kind of thinking. And that is really just like the movement of the mind, yeah? Because thought is the movement of the mind. So the most refined movement of the mind is not verbalization. It's just a slight wobble in the mind moving very, very slightly. Yeah? So that is what it means in the jhanas. It means the wobble of the mind. Yeah, and I know many people disagree with that, but I think that must obviously be the case, because these are very refined things. You're getting close to the end of the path when you come into the jhanas. The way the jhanas are described in the suttas as the footprint of the Tathagata, as the enlightenment, awakening happiness, as the Uttarimanusadhamma, the superior human states, and all of these things, it shows that these things are extraordinarily profound. And it's very important not to underestimate them. If you underestimate them, you're never going to find awakening at all. Why? Because you stop halfway, you think, yeah, got the jhanas, and then you get something else, and you think, yeah, this must be stream entry, okay, that's all. You get a lot of that. Then you go on the internet, you type in the word Arahant, you come to this website. Yeah, I am Arahant so and so. Yeah. And in the morning I meditate, in the evening often I go to work. Yeah. And I kind of hang out with my wife the rest of the time. It doesn't work like that. So there's a lot of, you know, please be a little bit skeptical when you see stuff. Don't be gullible. Gullibility is not very useful on the Buddhist path. Okay, nimitta, do they appear spontaneously in every occasion? Well, the word nimitta is used in different ways, yeah, in Buddhism. And very commonly, nimittas are just used typically in the in Buddhist circles as images in the mind. Yeah, so when you have an image in the mind, and something kind of appears, you see something in the mind's eye, it's often called a nimitta. Like you get a little bit of samadhi and you get all these visual things happening. Yeah. The other way that nimitta is used, it is used to describe what happens when you become incredibly peaceful and the light starts to arise in the mind. It's like the sun or something arising inside of you. Yeah. You see this very bright object that is often called, that is often what we mean by nimitta. And does it always arise? I think that that is the standard way in which people attain samadhi. You watch the breath, you become peaceful, you get all the joy and happiness in the world, then this bright light arises, you focus on that and it takes you into the Dharma state. So I think basically the answer to that is probably yes. And if you read the suttas, there's a different word used for this, it's called upasa. If you go to Majjhima Nikaya 128, they talk about light and vision of forms. Yeah, so you have a light arising in the mind, and that then carries you into the Dharma states. It's another way of talking about the same idea. So I would argue that the answer probably is yes, that you always have to go through the nimittas to attain Dharma. So, kasina meditation and practice, for whom is it useful and when? You can do kasinas if you want to, if you want to experiment a little bit with kind of, you know, these kind of more unusual meditation practices, please feel free to do so. I personally prefer to stick with those things that were taught by the Buddha as central meditation topics, like the mindfulness of breathing, which is the most important one in the suttas. That's what I would stick with. But if you find you want to do something different, you can. When is it useful and to whom? I don't really know the answer to that. I think that the answer probably is something like, if you find it useful and it helps you to attain samadhi, then it is the right time for you to use it. Yeah. So test it out, and if you find that it actually works for you, then use it. If you find that it doesn't actually have an effect, well then kind of go back to the breath or whatever else that you're doing here. But generally, I would recommend people to just stick with the breath, because if you can focus on one object, normally you can focus on any object. Because the idea of samadhi is the same. The idea is that you need mindfulness first of all. Regardless what object you're going to choose, you need mindfulness first of all. And once you have mindfulness, focusing on an object becomes possible regardless of what it is. So, I hope that helps. Okay. Okay, how can a being that is reborn in the animal realm have the opportunity to make good karma? Mostly they are driven by mere instinct, e.g. if a being is born as a predator, it has to kill others beings to survive. Yes, that is exactly right. So once you are reborn as an animal, it's difficult to get out of it. And the Buddha says as much in the suttas. He says that once you are reborn in that realm, actually you are tend to be stuck there for a long, long time as a consequence. Because precisely there is no making of good karma, no making of good merit in that realm. So you can imagine yourself if you are a predator animal, yeah, you go around killing all kinds of other beings. Are you making bad karma because of that? Probably a tiny bit of bad karma. Why? Because you have to have the intention. Yeah, you have intention to kill. But because you don't really understand what you're doing, probably it's only a very, very tiny amount of that karma in that situation. You're kind of driven, as you say, by instincts. But you tend to get stuck for a long, long period of time because of that. So if you want to help an animal to be reborn in a good place, let's say that you have a pet, for example, a pet dog or a pet cat, be kind to your pet. Yeah, the kinder you are to the pet, the more happy the pet is likely to feel, because of that happiness, because of that kind of brightening up of the mind of the pet. I think that is the best way to help your pet having a good rebirth in the future. But even that may not help, at least you're doing your very best in that situation. Okay. Dear Atharama, during the breath meditation, are we in fact programming the mind? Sometimes when I sit on the cushion, I notice my mind automatically knows what it has to do and continues from the last session. I notice the breath calms down fairly quickly and then goes straight to the mind without observing the in and out breath in too much detail. Should this happen, or do I need to watch all the steps in the in and out breath slowly before watching the mind? No, you don't have to watch all the steps. As you say, it is a lot of programming. Yeah, the programming kind of makes things happen automatically. So if it happens automatically, you don't have to go through all the steps. Great. Yeah, makes it simpler. If it doesn't happen automatically, I would recommend you to go back to the beginning every time. Go from the start, make sure everything is right. Sometimes you can do it very, very quickly because you know everything is okay. And then ensure that the foundations are in place. And that will make it possible to make quicker progress. If you are really, really skilled in meditation practice, you can just close your eyes and can go straight to the nimittas. Yeah? Bang, into dharmas, just like that. If you are really... skilled is the wrong term, because it's not about skill, it's about having a developed mind. That's really the right terminology here. If you're really developed in meditation, it can be incredibly fast. But it helps to be kind of a stream enter or something to do that. Unfortunately. Okay, so that was all from yesterday. Now we can move on to the questions from today. Dear Ajahn, considering the issues with Bhikkhu Bodhi's translations we are using on this retreat, do you think you will use Bhaktisiddhanta's translation in the future? Well, the thing is that if I take Bhaktisiddhanta's one, I will probably fall fine with those as well, right? This is the problem. No two people ever see completely eye to eye. This is the problem. And the point is not that I am a better translator than Bhikkhu Bodhi or Bhaktisiddhanta. On the contrary, both of them are probably far better than me in some respects, at least. The problem is that there are so many issues, and there's always some issues where someone sees more clearly than someone else, and it's always going to be like that. And so, for example, I'm not sure if I like Anasudato's translation of samadhi. For example, he uses immersion as his translation for samadhi. To me, it is a bit too cold. It doesn't really have any kind of doesn't have any kind of feeling to it. Immersion, okay. It probably is descriptive of what happens in a certain way. But I like Ajahn Ram's term, stillness, because stillness, actually you feel, you know what that means. It has a direct and immediate emotional impact on you when you hear that. It sounds good, it sounds positive. Immersion sounds kind of okay. Don't know, maybe good, maybe bad, but it's a descriptive rather than emotional immersion. So this is the problem. So there are all of these translations have issues, regardless of which one you choose, except your own translation, of course. That has no issues. That too isn't perfect. Yeah, that's the problem. I was going to say it's perfect, but of course it isn't perfect. Because that too, you have to make choices. You have to choose one way or another way. So sometimes what you have to do is actually discuss the text, and then you get some idea of what it actually means. So, but maybe we should use Bhaktisiddhanta's translations in the future anyway. Maybe that will be interesting, to see how that works out. Maybe we can kind of compare the two and then kind of criticize both. That would be really good, wouldn't it? Really get the critical mind going. Okay. Dear Ajahn, the other day you mentioned that there are a lot of dodgy Buddhist monks. Why are they allowed to carry on? Why were they ordained in the first place? I assume that all monks are ordained, and if not, they can be recognized by their robe. Is that so? Not all monks, so-called monks, are ordained. Somebody, like I said yesterday, just put on a brown robe and they walk around pretending to be monks. You're not actually monks at all. If you're not ordained, you're not a monk. Yeah, that's kind of the basic basic line. There's not everyone is a monk, so you have to be a little bit, watch out a little bit, especially when you see monks walking around in London or in Perth or whatever it is, begging for money, and they look a bit shady, and you know, you have reasons to be a bit careful with that. Monastics, generally speaking, should not be asking for money. Money is not something monastics should have in the first place. Of course, the reality is that the vast majority of monastics use money, but actually they shouldn't. It's actually against one of the rules of the monastic code. So if someone is begging for money, you can give them a bit, give them an apple. Let's see what they say. They would look, well, I want apple, I want money. Yeah, what is this? What is this apple all about? So, but that is what they're supposed to ask for. It's like food, yeah? That's what they're supposed to survive off. So, why are they allowed to carry on? Well, dodginess comes in degrees, yeah? They are really dodgy, and then middle dodgy, and then kind of just dodgy. Yeah? So the really dodgy ones, I agree, if you really are dodgy, and you do all kind of terrible things, and sometimes you hear all kind of disastrous stories coming out of various places, in those cases, they should be disrobed, they shouldn't be monks anymore. Yeah. And the reason why they can't carry on is because nobody takes issue with it. These days, fortunately, in places like Thailand, there is more pressure on dodgy monks to disrobe. The government has kind of stepped in a little bit to sort out all the corruption and bad things that's going on. And sometimes that is necessary. It's necessary for the secular governments, yeah, to actually step in, because the monastic institutions are not able to control their own monks. And this is a problem. But then there are kind of the not really dodgy, but monks who do things and are not right according to the Vinaya, because they have been taught that way. So the vast majority of monks or nuns who use money, the reason they do that is not because they are bad or evil. The reason is usually because that's what they were told. Yeah, they grew up as little novices, and they said, yeah, everybody uses money. So they did so too. Huh? And this is part of the problem. Huh? So don't judge too quickly. Huh? Yeah, and so a little bit of breaking of precepts can be expected. So what we should do instead is to tell them, well, you know, are you aware that this is against one of the rules? Maybe you shouldn't be collecting money. Yeah, maybe there's a better way. And they think, oh yeah, maybe you have a point. Yeah. And sometimes people start out with using money, but because you skillfully guide them in the right direction, they give it up and they become better as a consequence. Because sometimes they have just learned the wrong thing from the teachers. Why were they ordained in the first place? Well, a lot of monks are ordained for all kinds of reasons that have nothing to do with really wanting to live the spiritual life. They were ordained because of family pressure. They were ordained because they wanted a vocation. They were ordained because they were the easy way to eat food. Yeah, every day. Yeah. You get a meal as a monk. Yeah? Makes sense? So, this happened at the time of the Buddha. Yeah, seriously, it's not okay. Kind of the parents were thinking, our son, how can we ensure that our son kind of he has a nice meal every day, he kind of gets a nice place to rest, and he can kind of have a good life? How can we do that? And then they saw the monks. Well, these monks, they eat really well, yeah, and they sleep really well afterward. Okay, ordained son, that's the way for you to kind of be looked after. Yeah. This is how corruption happens. If you are ordained because you want to have a meal every day, that is your reason for being a monk, of course. It is not going to be very spiritually beneficial to you. And this is how these things happen. And as I mentioned yesterday, monks very often, they have very important roles in the community. They act as teachers, they act as doctors and all this kind of thing. This is traditional in traditional Buddhist countries like Thailand and Sri Lanka. Very important roles in the community, but with a modern society now penetrating everywhere, these roles are kind of dying out, and for that reason the monastic sangha is actually declining quite fast. The number of monks is going down. It's actually a good thing. people often think, oh, the number of monks has gone down, it's terrible. Actually, no, it's good that it's going down, because those monks, who, the majority of those monks, weren't that interested in the real monastic life anyway. Yeah. Okay, dear Ajahn Brahmani, would you mind to give a guided metta and death contemplation meditation during this retreat? Thank you. Yes, let's do that. Good idea. I'll put that to one side so I don't forget about it. Dear Ajahn Brahmani, modern society and culture seems to run against Buddhist principles more and more these days. Proliferation and indulging the senses to the maximum seems to be the new ideal. Should we protect ourselves to some extent from these very prevalent attitudes in society? And if so, how do we do that? The way to do that is simply to keep on reminding yourself of what matters in life, what is important, yeah? It is not very hard to see that these things are very superficial things. Indulging in, you know, in all kinds of sense pleasures, it doesn't really do anything. You indulge, and then you afterwards you still want to indulge more. There's no end there. It doesn't take you anywhere. You indulge your whole life, and then you die, and then you carry on indulging your next life, and it carries on like that forever. It doesn't take you anywhere. Just running around, doing nothing. So just the best way to remind yourself of these things is to keep on reading and listening to Dhamma. Yeah? Always bring yourself back to the suttas, bring yourself back to the word of the Buddha. This is the foundation upon which everything else builds in Buddhism. This is why the Kalyanamitta is the starting point in Buddhist practice. That's where everything starts. That's why right view is at the beginning point of the Noble Eightfold Path. This is why everything comes out of the hanging out with the noble ones, listening to the noble ones, especially the Buddha, because he's like the first one. So if you do that, if you keep on reminding yourself of the Dhamma by listening to the right kind of talks, reading the suttas again and again and again, brainwashing yourself if you like it. Yeah, it is kind of brainwashing, but it's a good brainwashing, because you get brainwashed regardless, you have no choice in that matter. You either get brainwashed by society, bad brainwashing, or you get brainwashed by the Buddha, good brainwashing. So choose the good brainwashing, then you are on the right track. Yeah. So that is what I would recommend. And as you do that, and that you will reinforce your practice, reinforce your ability to do all the good things, then you will be on the right track. Yeah. It is so hollow, so much of what goes on in our society. One of the wealthiest people in Australia was a fellow called James Packard. I don't know if you may have heard of him. He's very wealthy, owns casinos all over the place and all kinds of stuff. You know, billionaire basically, and his father died a few years ago, and he kind of took over this empire that the father had built up. And one of the interviews that I read with him soon after he had taken over his father's empire, he said, and when I read that, I knew that this fellow, he is doomed. Yeah, he's going to think they're going to go bad for this fellow. He said in that interview, "The one who dies with the most toys wins." Yeah, and I thought, I know that this is kind of an expression people use, not intended to be taken 100% seriously, that kind of stuff, but still, just to say that, especially in a newspaper interview, it's just madness. It shows you how hollow it is, yeah, and how kind of stupid it is. And of course, it turns out that now he has lots of problems with depression and all kind of things. Yeah, here he is, from a worldly point of view, super successful. He's the kind of the boss of this massive empire. Extremely wealthy, he's got everything that everyone wants, but he's a mess, complete mess. Inside, he's got nothing. What would you rather have? Would you rather have your psychology, your mind together and working properly, or would you rather be wealthy? What is more important? It's far more important to be together inside than to have all the material goods in the whole world. Far more important. So we have just got everything upside down in this world. Yeah, we have kind of misunderstood what really matters. So, you know, don't read all those stupid tabloid newspapers and all the kind of things that always tries to remind you of, you know, all this celebrity gossip and all this complete nonsense. It's just madness. Keep on brainwashing yourself with the Buddha's teachings. And as you do so, you will be on the right track. You're heading in the right direction. The world is so shallow, yeah, it's so hollow, it's just so, it's almost, It's kind of scary sometimes what people get up to. Anyway. Dear Adam, why do plants not have consciousness? They respond to our love and feelings and they are living beings. If this is true, we should not kill them and eat them. Please explain the Buddhist view. Thank you. If you can't kill plants, you have a problem. Yeah, you can't eat animals, you can't eat plants. What are you going to eat? Rocks. You have to eat rocks. Okay, rocks are not very tasty, so I'm not sure that's going to work out. I think the answer, I'm not sure of the answer to this one. It's actually quite a complicated one. But in the Vinaya Pitaka, there is a rule against monks destroying plants. And in that rule, the Buddha says that ordinary people, they take plants to have one sense, one sense consciousness, the sense of touch. Yeah, that's what the Buddha says. So the Buddha says that it's not that he thinks that, he says ordinary people think this. And because of that, we have to kind of satisfy the demands of society, otherwise they're going to look down upon us and think of us as bad monks. So he does it to satisfy the criticism of the lay people around him. So I would say the evidence from the suttas is that plants do not have consciousness. But then again, there are some modern experiments where it seems like plants have some ability to react to the environment. Is that because of consciousness? Is it because of some automatic process going on? I don't know. I don't really know the final answer to this. And it's going to be interesting to see what when science does more experiments on plants, if we can find out that this thing will be interesting. And I think we can assume until further notice that plants do not have consciousness. And it becomes very problematic if you can't eat plants. What are we going to eat then? What can we eat? We can drink water, I suppose. What else can we do? Maybe what we have to do is just to wait, like they did in the old days, wait for the fruit to drop from the trees. Yeah? Sit under the tree, wait for the mango to drop. And then when the mango, okay. Just made it time before I die. Yeah? I died, got the mango, came down. Okay, eat the mango there. But you can't eat a seed, right? Because a seed is alive. You've got to be careful there. So, okay, enough messing around it now. Let's do the next one. Venerable Sir, what happens to one's consciousness when we die? If it does not enter a receptive womb or get reborn in some other way. What happens to consciousness if it does not get, it will get reborn some other way. Yeah? It's impossible to avoid that. That's the whole point. Because if you have consciousness and you have craving, craving is what drives rebirth. Yeah, it's irrelevant whether, it's irrelevant what happens apart from that. As long as you have craving, you will be reborn somewhere. That is what drives consciousness forward. If you have no craving, then consciousness will come to an end the moment you die. That's what happens then. Yeah? No more rebirth. That's what the idea of no more rebirth is. Paticca Samuppada says, avijja nirodha, from the cessation of delusion comes the cessation of sankhara, sankhara nirodha. And sankharas are the intentional activities. From when the intentional activity ceases, vijnana nirodha, consciousness ceases, and straight from dependent origination. Okay. Ajahn Brahmali, why do we lock our doors? And then there's all this lamb, all this sheep with metta. Okay. Okay, that's very, very cute, all the three sheep on the thing here. Why do we lock our doors? We don't have to lock your door. You can leave it open if you wish. There is no force. Maybe it's because, as you say, you are a sheep that's following along. You don't have to. I guess why we lock our doors is because we are attached. Yeah, attached to belongings, attached to things. Or it could simply be that you are being realistic sometimes. Sometimes you have to lock your doors. You are realistic. You need things. You have to have them even if you're not attached to them. It's handy to have a few clothes around, that sort of stuff. So we lock your door for that reason. Once in our monastery in Perth, we had an anagarika, one of the people in white, and we have a prison not far from the monastery. Yeah, one of these prisoners had escaped from prison, happens all the time. It's one of these open prisons where it's very easy to escape. And then they come to the monastery. This prisoner came to the monastery, was running around trying to kind of find some clothes or whatever. He went to this undergarment and took all his clothes. Yeah. And then he was walking around in white probably somewhere. White is better than green, yeah, or prison stripes or whatever. I don't think they have prison stripes, but anyway, that's only in the cartoons they have prison stripes. So they stole all his clothes, yeah? And that is when he started locking his door after that. That's why he locked your door. Not because it was attached to it, but he needed those whites. Because he was a scavenger. So this is the reason. But it's an interesting point you make it, because often we lock our doors out of fear and all kinds of reasons, out of attachment. So, please be sensible, yeah? And it is important to recognize that we have attachments. It's okay to have attachments, and it's okay to lock your door if you have attachments. Because we cannot overcome attachments by just not locking our doors. It's too easy that way, yeah? Okay. Okay, dear Ajahn, in the Majjhima Nikaya 27, full version, in other words, the sutta we have been having a look at so far, is a reference to disciples only eating one meal a day. Yet this seems to have evolved into breakfast and lunch. What is the reason? Oh, you're trying to embarrass me now. Are you trying to put me on the spot? The reason is, it says eka bhattika is a Pali word. And that eka bhattika can be interpreted two ways. Either as one meal a day or as in a meal in only one period of the day. Yeah. But the actual Vinaya rule, what the Vinaya rule says, which is these are the actual rules for the monastics, it says that you should eat between dawn and midday, yeah, the meridian, when the sun is kind of in the zenith. That's what the actual rule says. So there isn't really any rule against monastics eating one meal a day. It's perfectly allowable, actually. But it seems to have been fairly common at the time of the Buddha to have one meal a day. One of the reasons that we instituted, we actually used to have only one meal a day at Bodhinyana Monastery. And then they decided to have two. And one of the reasons why they decided that was because in the early days, they were working really, really hard. Yeah, they were working like 10 hours a day, hard physical work. Yes, it was much harder than in prison, kind of breaking rocks in prison. It was really hard physical work. And for that reason, Ajahn Brahm even, who has a very strong constitution, even he got ill from that. So they decided, okay, let's have two meals a day because we are actually working really, really hard. So it depends on the situation, the circumstances. Of course, if you look at Ajahn Brahm now, you think that one meal a day might just be enough. So that's a different issue. Don't tell Ajahn Brahm. Keep quiet. It's a serious problem.
It's
all right. So, oh, no, dear. Did he button there? No, it's okay.
I can message.
No, you don't have to edit. I'm messing with that.
I'm
a monkey. Okay. Yeah, no, that's fine. I don't mind. If he hears, it's probably good, actually. I need to kind of be a bit cheeky sometimes. So basically, it is not a problem from a Vinaya point of view, but yes, it is arguable that the way that the best monastic practice in those days, and even now, in the right circumstance at the right time, is actually eating one meal a day. But it depends on all kinds of issues, and there is no problem there with eating twice, or you can, in theory, you can eat 10 times between dawn and midday. Yeah? Okay, dear Ajahn, is it only through continued practice on one-pointed concentration that you can increase your mindfulness? Is our goal to increase mindfulness that we can guard our six senses and also our defilements? Thank you. It is actually the other way around. Yeah, you don't practice one-pointedness first to get mindfulness. You practice sensory strength first, so that you get mindfulness, and then you get the stillness of the mind, and the, not concentration, but the stillness of samadhi, yeah? You have to get the right order here. So first you guard your senses, then comes mindfulness from that, then you get the stillness. So, yeah, so you do also increase your mindfulness by getting stillness, of course, because the more still your mind is, the more powerful your mindfulness is going to be. But it really is the other way around. Mindfulness, then stillness. And the reason for that is because all real samadhi, mindfulness is one of the elements of samadhi. Yeah, you have to have mindfulness to be able to have samadhi. So, first of all, you come into the present moment. Present moment is not necessarily one point, that the mind can still be scattered through the six senses. And then once you have that mindfulness, then you focus it in on one object. But you are still mindful when you are concentrated, when you are still. Yeah? So you have to get things in the right sequence. This is why virtue is the foundation of mindfulness. Practice virtue, practice kindness in your life, practice all these good qualities, which include sense restraint. Then mindfulness will emerge as a matter of course. Then meditation will happen. That is the right sequence. Okay, dear Ajahn, can you explain how to spot that you are deluded if you are deluded? This is a good question, yeah, because it is very problematic. How do you know that you are deluded if you are deluded? And sometimes you know, because sometimes you feel confused, you feel all over the place, you know that now I'm pretty deluded actually. But of course, the deeper delusions, the delusions that have to do with the sense of self and all of that, actually, it is impossible to know that you are deluded. Or you can maybe have some inkling, because sometimes you see other people, they get meditation very easily, they are able to sit for long periods of time, they have a lot of wisdom, and you know you haven't got it, so you can almost infer that you have some delusion there. So you can have some perspective on it, but the really deep stuff is actually very, very hard to know. So often you have to go by faith in the Buddha's teachings. Yeah, this is already a degree of understanding that you can read the suttas and you have confidence in the suttas, the word of the Buddha. It means you have some understanding, even if you are deluded. This is kind of the magical and strange thing about this. We are deluded, and yet somehow we recognize that there is a deeper truth there available somewhere there. And one of the beautiful sayings, I think it is found, I'm not sure where it is found, I'm getting a bit tired now, I should probably stop here actually. But somewhere the Buddha says something to the effect that the person who knows that they are deluded, they are at least wise to that extent. But the deluded person who does not know they're deluded, well, they are completely lost. Yeah, they have no chance at all. So if you understand a little bit of your own delusion, actually, good on you. What? It's good. Yeah, it's a wonderful thing that you actually know that. You know that you are confused and you haven't got that clarity. Because that gives you the possibility to get out of it. If you don't know you are deluded, there's no chance of getting out of it. Because you think everything is all right. So, this is basically the short answer to that one, I suppose. But I'm going to stop there because my mind is no longer up to answering these questions, I think. I kind of reached my end point for today. There's still a few questions left, so can we do the same with it yesterday? Yeah, great. Okay, I'll leave it to you to sort out. So let us all tonight have a good, nice rest as usual, and let's just pay respect to the Buddha Dhamma Sangha as the final thing here.